statistically, there are too many of us in the room to be able to answer the question this morning and answer it positively, how great is your God? Theoretically, we can all answer that the same, but this morning, numbers are too many. There's somebody struggling this morning. There's somebody that's struggling in marriage, in home, with your kids, in your journey of patience with the next job or the place you're supposed to be, right? Anybody? You can answer that quietly to yourself. But statistically, it's hard to say that he's good all the time when sometimes it doesn't seem like he's good. But he is all the time. This morning, we're going to have a conversation related to understanding what it means to know and share the gospel. We've been through Acts, and we've been not through it, but in it, in studying what it looks like to declare the glory of God to others that don't know it. The whole aim of studying Acts is to understand discipleship. And it's to understand discipleship also with the understanding of harvest. There are people that don't know the gospel, that don't have hope, don't understand what it means to see God as good all the time, but for us to show it. This morning, I want us to spend a few minutes as we look at the series that we've been in to understand some different tools that are there as resources. And I'll be the first to say, this message this morning is a combination of teaching and preaching, which means those two to you, you might think those are the same thing, but I'll explain my definition of both, which isn't mine, but it is a lexicon definition. So teaching would be me taking declared truth and teaching it to you as fact. You understand it. You regurgitate it. You give it back to me. You say, yes, I believe that. Yeah, we agree. You've now learned something that maybe you didn't before. Preaching, though, is spirit-filled, giving of truth, evidencing the greatness and goodness of God all the time. Done so through the marriage of the Holy Spirit for the people of God as we bring the Word of God. You see the difference, right? Palpable difference. This morning, I want us to see three methods. They're just methods, and they're quick, but there's three of them, so it takes a little time to get through them, to understand how we are called to share and declare the gospel. Before I do, though, let me give you some dates. October 20th, 1986. January 19th, 1992. February 1, 2006. And right now, you're thinking those dates have no significance in your life. Because they don't. They're significant to me because there are certain things on those days that the Lord did for me to understand. He is God, and I am, say it with me, not, right? That's an important thing for us to recognize this morning. You and I are not what? God. But obedient to Him out of love and adoration for what He's done in us. So these are three methods at which to declare and know the gospel. My life's journey began way ahead of 86, but to understand on that January evening, excuse me, wrong date, October evening of January 20th, 1986, Ezekiel 36:26, a heart of stone was turned into a heart of flesh of understanding. One that's cold and hard toward God will not receive Him, but one that is alive toward Him will hear Him and bring in everything He has to say and love it with adoration. So to you that are married this morning, does the gospel reign centered of all your marriage? Meaning, that's what bleeds out in the everyday argument. Is the gospel or is it self-centeredness? So just put that on like a pause plate to think about that for a second. On that October evening, at Awana's, of all places, our youth pastor, the church that my family attended, was giving the story of Joshua fighting the Battle of Jericho. Nothing significant about it, besides the evidence that that's a crazy story. Go fight a war by going and marching around the city, be there for 7 days. On the seventh day, march around it seven times. And it's the seventh time, everybody does what? You blew your trumpet. Everybody got a trumpet? Let's hear your trumpet. Ready? This is teaching, not preaching. You're going to join me. Ready? Sorry, awful. Come on. Trumpet. People of God, come on, we're going to conquer here. Ready? One more time. One, two, three. Yeah, you sound like a bunch of cockatoos. Never mind. The cockatoos have landed. And at the same time, you're going to yell and scream. What they screamed, I don't really know. But the walls fell down. as a 10-year-old boy hearing that story, I'm like, how stupid. But the Lord did what he promised would happen. If I was asked that, hey, go lead your army in this way, are you kidding me? I might as well go stand on the wall and let them pour hot tar on me and then light it on fire. So in that November evening, faith came into a collision course with knowledge. Because I grew up in the church. I mean, I had the Children's Living Bible. In Matthew, there's a picture of the cross and the agony of Golgotha. And Jesus hung there, so I believed it from a factual standpoint. But Joshua in that story made a collision course, and now I have faith to believe it. Some of you hold your laughter at this, but I was an odd kid as a little kid. And I would prefer to sleep on the shag carpet floor instead of my nice, comfortable bed. I think the Lord was preparing me to love camping in the outdoors more than just comfort creatures of life. But that evening, after Awana's, my mom came in to like do the goodnight thing, and she says to me, Matt, what'd you learn tonight at Awana's? She didn't know anything. I said, Mom, I have to have the same kind of faith that Joshua had to fight the battle of Jericho. I don't need to know the where and the when or the why or the how, but to live by faith. How do you think my mom received that? You what? I remember she prayed, she marched me up. I was the youngest, so she took me downstairs. My siblings were still up, and my dad goes, tell everybody what just happened to Awana's tonight. What was she wanting to signify? The importance of understanding the collision between knowledge and believing creates transformation. That's what we're talking today. That's the conversation we're having today. So the church, we're aiming at discipleship and harvest. And in our aim and our journey through Acts, we have some tools to help us. The cause circle we looked at a couple weeks ago. To start to earnestly make lists of people and think through who are the people in my life in which I should probably think about out of love for them, out of respect for them, and out of just honor to them, start praying for opportunity to declare the truth of who Christ is. At that moment, your delivery of it has nothing to do with their reception of it. Did you understand that? You're delivering out of obedience. They're receiving however the Lord has tuned their ears to hear it. You're responsible as what? I deliver the word. They're responsible for the what? Hearing of the word. And in the middle, there's this thing we call faith and trust that God's going to do a work. So in our cause circles, we understand the simple tool built around the priority of understanding the practice during this. How do we think about this? How do we act in this? How intentionally do you place areas of your life to allow access to you for both relationship and conversation in which this can happen? You're like, say what? Do you structure your life in some way to give access to people, to you, the holder of the truth of the gospel? Out of that access, now you gain relationship. And now that relationship, guess what? You gain respect and trust and availability. So those are just some Matt Johnson thoughts anchored into this. But in this cause circle, we understand today that we have then the ability to be the influence for the gospel. The Lord moved us to this area, and I didn't make this correlation and connection until last week in Chad's preaching. He says, when the Lord asks you to do something, how obedient are you, for one, and how much do we create gaps to push off to say, not today, not today, not today? In our response to the Lord asking of us and working in situations to move us to this great part of Ohio, the cause and the people were people that were anchored in that circle. Six individuals that we're going to move to Ohio to live with them so that we can have access to them to declare the goodness of God all the way down to how stupid you are, Matt. You have 7 months left. If you just stay in the school district for 7 months, you'd be vested into your insurance for retirement for the rest of your life. Your pension would be secure. I did the math. And if I would have chose to wait for those 7 months to be up, two of my daughters would have been standing in the hallway in which that shooting occurred. Last week was pretty loud at the end of the service for me. I'm like, if, Lord, you don't weigh on us in such a way that we respond in obedience. Some of you don't even know what that means. I'll be honest. You've never experienced Spirit in such a way that you're like, what am I listening to? The gentle promptings and nods and pushes of the Lord for you to be, one, in His presence, and two, to understand truth, and three, to be receptive to it. We can wear a crown of our own life and our own authority, and the world preaches to you and I to be autonomous. Have you ever heard that? I think that is Satan's handiwork, because nowhere in the Scripture does the Scripture preach to us autonomy. We are His workmanship. We are created in His image. Who am I dependent upon? It'd be scary, but if I lift my shirt, I'll show you my belly button. Scary picture, right? My life is dependent upon someone else other than me. And since you can then go all the way back to Adam with that belly button. I want us this morning to understand within these cause circles, we have the ability, and we have three A's, and we have this three bubble drawings for God, and we have this 3A scenario. Have you ever met someone that's very disingenuous? Like, they come talk to you like, you are full of it. You fill in the it. I'm not going to fill that in. You don't mean what you're saying, and you're about all of this just for you. It has nothing to do with me. If we can look at the 3 A's here in a minute, we're going to understand the difference between ask, admire, and admit, and what those do for us in conversation. So we're compelled on a clear mission to go declare the gospel. You and I will live where we've studied in Acts 1:8, that we will receive the power of the Holy Spirit when it comes to you, and you and I will be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the other ends of the earth. I got news for you. You can pull Judea out of there and you put Michigan in there. You're like, what? Even people you don't love, that's who you're called to go serve. When I was in Michigan, I used to preach about Ohio the other way, okay? So my family's all from Ohio, so don't take it too personal. Wherever the Lord leads you, you need to understand, who am I? But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. My senior pastor in ministry that literally was at a moment where he was vulnerable and said, you know what, young man, I'm going to give access to myself to you that I don't give to other people. I didn't tell the full story. He, one time when we were missionaries, he was speaking where we were at, and he gave me a book. He says, I just want you to read this. Tell me your thoughts about it. I read it and had a phone conversation with him. I said, it's all just biblical theology. I don't get the problem. Why do people have a problem with that? Oh, you like that one? Good. Okay, here, read this one too. If you have ever been in my office, some of you have, there's walls of books. He bought every one of those books. He provided the access to more, to more, to more. Are you being that to someone? That you're giving them truth where they can't find it in any other way. So here we have actions to go through. You and I witness to someone, and we understand we share with our lips, with our words, our life actions are also speaking in a way that they complement one another. Both word and our actions are the same. When they're different, everyone knows it. You and I attest to the Spirit. Wherever you and I go, we take the Spirit along with us. So Philip here, when he's on the chariot that day, and let me just read this. Then Philip ran to the chariot and heard of the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you're reading? And Philip asked, how can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me. So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Then Philip began with that very passage of Scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. You're the interpreter. You. Right now that you're thinking in your head, Matt, I don't know the Bible well enough. I don't know my own worth well enough. I don't see my own purpose grand enough. I don't think I'm the one to help explain it. Do you remember when you were in the waters of baptism on that day that you were baptized? You made the confession. You made the full confession in your own redemptive story's point of view that you know Jesus is Savior. You are prepared. So be prepared. Be excited about being prepared. So here in these three bubbles, we see a quick way that you could just jot these down. If you're sitting with me, and in a moment, John's going to come be my coffee buddy. And John, it actually is warm coffee, still steaming. Like, it's true coffee. It's not just fake up here. John's going to come up here with me. And these, in this drawing, are tools at which you can use with hanging truth on. hang the fruit of the gospel on this tree of information. So you have these three circles drawn. The first circle is God's design. You and I would recognize, according to Romans 1, that God is the creator and sustainer of all things, right? So in a design, you don't have a design without a purpose or a pre-thought. God created us all into existence. Though we see right away, sin came into the world. Sin, exampled for us in brokenness. Adam and Eve, when they fell, they quickly knew of their nakedness, right? They covered themselves in guilt and shame. Think of all the situations that you have sat in where it seems like momentary chaos and calamity. Anybody? Anybody have a moment this week that, like, dude, it was crazy. Like, it was way outside of my control. I was unable to respond the way I should. Right? Brokenness comes, though, and it brings chaos. It brings calamity in our lives. And that is the example of all those crazy arrows going everywhere. How many guys live a perfect life? Be honest. Raise your hands. You're like, you have it made. You have everything you need. You never have a worry or anxious thought. That's right. None of us. Showing forth really this picture of what it looks like to repent and believe. In our brokenness, it's evident to us that we need a what? If we know our Bibles well, we need a Savior, a Redeemer. Somebody to take something that was wrong or different or broken and restore it back. So how do we look at that? We've inherited our brokenness from Adam, whether we like it or not. That declaration of my belly button shows my pre-existent condition to someone else, my mother, to her mother. Go all the way through the generations back. Guess where it started? You might get a narrow funnel at Noah and the flood. I get that. But it goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. So we have an understanding out of repentance and believing, repenting from our sin, turning from it, and saying, Lord, help me. That was my collision understanding between knowing the picture that was in my little kid's Bible and understanding Joshua fighting the battle where I go, whoa, that's different. That's silly. Who knows what 10-year-old-minded words I had. But we see believing. Believing in the good news of what Christ has done, even though I don't merit it, I don't deserve it, I didn't do anything for it. So we have the gospel. And we see that man's life has been restored back to God's design, to be a worshiper, edifying him as Savior, where I am not. Back to the same question, have you had a calamity-free week, or an argument-free week, or a rogue random thought in your head that you shouldn't have probably had free week? It's funny how just quickly we all said, oh man, that's not me. We're in this plan back where God's restoring us back himself. Today we gather as brothers and sisters in faith for one purpose, to make God glorified in who he is and what he's done and his plan, and we can come together, and room, hear me say this, we should be the greatest worshipers of God in such a way that the others that come with us are excited to have been with us this morning. How many guys ever leave church feeling empty, like disconnected? Be honest. Be honest. You ever feel like you've left and no one even spoke to me? No one said hi. Oh my gosh, I'm going to get worms and pie. Like whatever, right? We are the living gospel to one another. Your marriage, the very center of your gospel, is a daily rehearsal of why I should show grace to my spouse and not make it a screaming match. Is the gospel really centered? It affects more than just my delivery with somebody that doesn't know Christ. I've changed my notes since first service, so I'm going to clip through three slides real quick because you already got them. Got them? Got them written down? There you go. Last chance. Okay. Methods. These are all just methods. Means at which I can sit down across the table from someone, hence why we got this little table. In a minute, John's going to join me up here. Is it easier to stand in the grocery store line with somebody and declare to them a sinner? Say, what? Think about the context of that. Standing in the grocery store line probably is a staggering place to have a really good conversation because you're both doing what? Beep, 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 beep. Have you ever been on the phone with somebody at Walmart when they're checking out? Beep, 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 beep. You're like, you know right where they're at. Maybe it's the beginning point of the conversation, but maybe it's not the ending point of the conversation.
I switched those because I drank the other one with white on it. I didn't want John to have my germs. Let's look at this acrostic for a second. Maybe this is something that you have a picture of on your phone that just helps you. I have an app on my phone that I can walk somebody through a gospel conversation in 2.5 minutes. So God, our sins, pain, everyone, life. These are words that can help you. Again, just a method. When I was in college, my first 2 years were in pastoral studies, and I thought, what if I'm never a pastor? What am I going to do to make a living? So I transferred schools. I'm now at a state school. I'm at Western Michigan University. And I'm walking through campus one day from a class to my office. I was the editor of one of the editors of the paper. And I'm going to my office, and there's this guy standing just outside this big library stairs. And this guy's wearing two pieces of plywood. One's painted red, and the other side's painted white. And I thought, what is this guy up to? And I hear yelling, raw, 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 as I got closer, raw, 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 Jesus, anointing. And I hear these words. I'm like, what is this guy doing? He's preaching the gospel. As he's standing in front of it, probably well over 100 people, maybe 150 people, placarded in, "You sinner," on the front. "Jesus saves" on the back. I'm thinking, brother, turn that sign around. He's doing more damage yelling at people. "I'm sure you were at the bar last night. I'm sure you were having sex with somebody. I'm sure you're," and he assured me. He picked me out of the crowd. He damned, I won't fall, I promise. He damned me in my existence. And he says, "Today I bet you don't even have hope. Where does hope lie within you?" He says, "My hope hangs in one place, and that's on the cross." "Well, where are you going to go when you die?" "I'm going to reign with him in heaven forever." He had the right message, but did he have the most effective delivery? And of all the people, of the 100-and-some people that he screamed at in the midst of that group of people, how did God lay on him to say, "Hey, you, what is the hope that lies within you?" And actually, there was truth given for once in the moment. I literally walked away from my office, or walked onto my office like, "Lord, how did you just arrange that in such a way that of all those people that were like laughing at this guy, he points to me and asks me for the hope that lied within me?" I'm sure he was waiting for some wrong answers so he could just lambaste me. And that whole thing just went, he didn't know what to say anymore. Gospel. When we look and understand gospel and these six words as these sentences, not in your notes, but listen for them. I'm going to give you verses that go with these statements to help you see the figure and theological understanding of who God is out of these. God created us to be with him. Did he really? Your purpose on this earth is to be created to be with God. Maybe you never knew that. Revelation 4:11. "You are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." Who's responsible for all this? You? Me? No, he is. We see that the O is our sins separate us from God. Hebrews 9:27. Write this reference down. Hebrews 9:27. "Just as people are destined once to die, what are we all surely going to do? Pay taxes and your trumpets are needing some air. Pay taxes and die." Okay? It's guaranteed to us. It's outside of us. "Just as people are destined to die once and after that face judgment." Well, that's not fair. I didn't ask for this. Adam and Eve sinned. Brings us to the S, sins. Sins cannot be removed by good deeds. They can't be overwhelmed. So October 20th, 1986, the listening to the word in the story proclaimed, I came to a moment of faith. For years, I've wrestled with this. My parents met with a pastor. I met with a pastor. And he says, "This, Matt, here's how this is going to work." I'm like, "Here's how this is going to work. Like, it's already done." I was a 10-year-old. Okay, next Sunday. Well, that's not good on my schedule. The Sunday after that, I'm going to preach an altar call sermon. You're going to come forward. I'm already confessing Jesus. Your sermon has nothing. At 10, I'm like rationalizing this. Your sermon has nothing to do with this. Your preaching is not before men. Your teaching is not before men. It's not so they can go, oh, look, he spoke a sermon today and that young man came forward. How good of that young man. False. Lies. No different smoke and mirrors. Understand specifically, sins cannot be removed by good deeds. It doesn't matter what the church presents itself to look like. Isaiah 53:6. In your conversation with somebody that doesn't know the Bible, help them to understand this is written about Jesus way before Jesus. But listen to the clarity of it. We, all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah 53:6. Written decades and generations ahead of who God actually was incarnate as Christ. Declare the glory of future grace coming. The P, paying the price for sin. Jesus died and rose again. Praise be, this is 1 Peter 1:3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth of a living hope. How? Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The significant death of Jesus over any other man is the raising on the resurrection. The grave couldn't hold him. The E, everyone who trusts in him alone has eternal life. Everyone who trusts in him alone has eternal life. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life. For God's wrath remains on them. John 3:36. And the last is this, life. Life with Jesus starts now and it lasts forever. You can't lose it. John 10:28. No one can snatch you out of the Father's hands. Hallelujah moment, right? It is the eternal thing. It is not a man-centered thing. There's nothing you can do to jeopardize it or to remove it amongst the fact that it's true in your life. So this morning, we need to ask this question. How can we have a genuine gospel conversation with people that we don't really feel like we know? In a manner in which they don't feel like they're targets, and as the slide says, they don't feel like they're projects. We communicate with them in such a way that they receive love. You're only having this conversation because you care for me. So John's going to come up here and join me for a second. And in my notes, I have written a modern-day parable version opposite of the Ten Commandments. Oh, you need a stool, brother. Here, have a seat. I care about you. I want you to have a seat right there. Have you ever been invited for a cup of coffee with someone? None of you. Okay, good. I invite people to coffee all the time. I purposely start my day. I drop Ellie off at Buckeye, and the daily grind for the first 3 hours, I just go sit there to see who talks to me and who I can talk to. I actually get a lot of work done in those 3 hours as I just zone in, get work done. I told Chad a few months ago, I said, I have now sat in the daily grind since, this is sad. I've sat in the daily grind every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, waiting for all these men that keep coming in and out carrying Bibles to say, hi, who are you? What's your name? My name's such and such and so and so. I told Chad, I finally made it a life game. I'm just going to sit here and see all these Christian men walking in and out, in and out. I have a Bible sitting in front of me. I'm just a man there working. Man, I see you here every day. The conversation can start simply. Hey, my name's Matt Johnson. Yours is?
John.
John, nice to meet you, John. How's your day going?
Oh, not too bad so far.
You make it sound like sometimes it does go bad.
Oh, not always perfect.
Not always perfect. I know why it's not perfect. You don't have a microphone. We'll make it better. You make it sound like there's trouble sometimes.
Yeah, I suppose I'm like most people. I have occasional problems.
Do you know where those problems even come from?
My wife causes a lot of problems.
That's a common answer. A lot of people I've met, they always point to their spouse. No, John, here's a funny story. My wife writes, sorry, Kiva, I owe you 10 bucks. My wife, on every anniversary card, she says, I will follow you wherever the Lord leads. It's interesting, her obedience to, like, be a supplier and giver of grace. Because I know there's days I'm not perfect in a lot of areas, but I right now. You're going to forgive him later, right? Every day we have trials and struggles. Do you know why there's trials and struggles besides your wife?
Probably because this world is not a perfect place.
Oh, man, it's not. Do you know why it's not perfect? Help me understand it. Give me your view on that.
Well, there's a lot of evil in this world.
Yeah.
Satan is roaming about seeking whom he may devour.
Man, you're speaking the Bible to me. How long have you known Christ? Do you know Christ, the Savior?
Absolutely.
How long have you known Christ?
Since I was about 16 years old.
And you've known him that long? You still threw your wife under the bus just now?
Well,
that's the authenticity that the conversation might need in reality. And this isn't rehearsed. Like, John, like, hey, would you come up? He's like, oh, okay, Matt, here we go. When you can allow someone access into your life, that is a fresh cup of coffee. We can, like, drink, like, thank you, Jesus, right? Coffee saves, according to Chad, maybe. Saves the moment. It's lukewarm. There's a parable about that, you know? The conversation is only as awkward as what? You and I, we make it. Though if you love something, if you genuinely love something, if you, out of understanding the scripture's commands to it, if you love me, you will finish the verse for me, somebody. Obey me. Maybe the prayer isn't, Lord, lead me to somebody to share the gospel to. Lord, help me understand the greatest commandment. How do I love the Lord my God with all my heart and all my soul? And I anchor that into others, get more of me out of that. Maybe we got the cart before the horse sometimes. Maybe we think out of duty I got to share the gospel and I got to ramrod into somebody's life. Let me read you this parable, John, and let me ask room, does this sound like John? Well, you appear to have mastered the art of multitasking, John. I see you know how to lie. I see you know how to cheat. I see you know how to steal joy from others. I see that you evidence that you hate your neighbors, and you even hate their barking dog. You worship sometimes the other deities. You sing golf clubs what you say to the glory of God, and your family enjoys binge-watching movies. You shop till you drop, and you despise both your parents and your parent-in-law. I see that your kids even lust after stashes of candy. And casually you pull off a murder mystery in your own mind of others because you hate them and despise them. All this while being the town's gossip and columnist writing about it, I guess it's safe to say that you're sinfully versatile and that you understand your neighbors and everyone love to talk about you. Is that probably a good way to start the gospel conversation? When you forcefully say to somebody, you're a rotten, awful, dirty sinner. John's smart enough, mature enough to agree at that moment. But how did that make you feel in that statement? Yeah. I'm not loving you to the gospel. I'm evidencing to you. I'm just going to shamefully point my finger at you until you feel like dirt. Here's a hard question, spouses. Do you ever set the gospel aside to make somebody else feel awful with your words? I'm talking to your spouse across the table from you. Do you declare the gospel at your home every day? And I'm not perfect. You can just ask my four beautiful women sitting over there. I'm not perfect. But I'm on a life's mission to understand I need to live the most godly life possible for somebody else to see and go, what's up with that person? Right? So as we walk through these conversations, you got to put these things into practice. Asking, not telling. Notice I didn't come to John and say, hey, I started with this funny right version of the Ten Commandments gone wrong, right? Don't start with that. You start by helping someone by really caring. Hey, what's going on in your world? Where you can leave with your hand on your shoulder, their shoulder, praying for them. John and I met for lunch 2 weeks ago. And it was literally brothers showing love for one another to push them to be better brothers. And in that, it's also the gospel. How do we take awkward moments and redeem them for the kingdom. For me, it's just saying hi and hello a lot. If you make conversation or you make eye contact, guess what you're going to get out of me? Hey, how you doing today? Like, I'm talking to me? Yeah, I'm talking to you. The second time they see me, like, don't we know each other? Well, I remember you. I said hi to you, and you ran like a fast flea out of the room. Like, oh, my gosh, that guy just talked to me. Giving access to people. Show yourself friendly for the sake of the gospel, not your introverted excuse. Because you love the gospel more than you love your own self-righteousness or your own self-comfort. So as we look at this, sharing the gospel is not that sophisticated. This morning, thank you, John. This morning, I want us to end with this as a conversation point. How do I share the gospel? That slide I went past through has red light, yellow light, green light. How to walk with someone. That is your spirit-filled observation. Please know that. It's obvious from a conversation with somebody, like, this is a stone-hard heart that wants nothing to do with this conversation. Probably red light. They're like, don't keep lambasting them. Just pray for another opportunity. Yellow light. Hey, soft. Hey, what do you feel about it? Like, ask some more poking, prodding questions. Here's the green light conversation. I want you to doodle in your notes section with me. If you draw two circles, a big circle and a small circle, make sure the small circle is really small, and the small circle is not at the bottom of your page, but the small circle is the top of your head as a stick figure. Got it? Big circle, small circle. If you don't have a pen and paper in front of you to draw this, draw it in your own mind, because I really want you to think about the analogy of what we're about to do. In the big circle, we recognize that is the earth, that is the cosmos, that's everything that can be created by a creating God who has design and purpose in mind. God, the creator and sustainer of all things, ex nihilo, breathed it into existence. It was that easy for him. So you have the world drawn big. That's what the big circle is. Above the world, I want you to draw the fanciest king's crown that you can draw. For the youth in the room, I want you to draw it in such a way that you're proud to come show it to me. Like, mine's bedazzled. It's got, like, the little gem holders on the top. Like, that's the crown of the Lord that is sovereign over all things and the creator of the earth. Now, your little stick figure dude, that's you. In the fall, in Adam and Eve's sin, you have put on the crown of your own life. You reign over your own decision-making. You're autonomous all of your own to usurp the authority in the spirit left and right, to understand I am a self-made man, and I'm going to declare my greatness. I'm going to live on me. Here's my question. Are you ready? How well is it going serving your own crown? How well is your life being run serving your own crown, only surrendered to you? My question this morning is this. Here's how you need to end your gospel conversation. It's not with a prayer. It's not with a false coming up front in a church service that makes it look like the rest of the service, wow, look at the power of the Holy Spirit in this preaching. This young 10-year-old kid comes forward. It's not in a date and a time when you pronounced it, but it's understanding the significance of who you are in it. God is way bigger than us. My question for you today is, which crown are you serving? Which crown are you surrendered to? If you can leave the gospel conversation with somebody that you maybe just met, or you're trying to love them to the Lord, with that question, they're aimed toward an understanding of lordship, salvation, that Jesus is the mediator. On that top crown above the world, I want you to take on that crown, and I want you to put the letter J. Redemption back to the Heavenly Father is made only possible because of the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, alone. Significant dates. I told you of the day of my salvation. January 19th, 1992, a pastor that is now, well, he wasn't a pastor then, he was a state trooper. Do you know that state troopers are good candidates to be pastors? Probably not your typical, right? Rough, tough, like by the book. At a retreat for youth, this man was preaching the gospel. And he's preaching on John 21. At the end of the weekend, he's preaching John 21 to say, hey, Jesus is calling you to serve him. Sitting in the back of that auditorium, same place that I'm trying to gather men to go to a men's retreat in May. It's a little commercial there. Sitting in the back of that auditorium, God got really loud in my life, and I'll tell you, the Holy Spirit came alive and said, Matt, don't worry about your finances and how to make a dollar the rest of your life. Be focused. Be focused when Jesus said, leave the net and follow me. Don't worry about the fish. Don't worry about taking the market. Don't worry about selling them to take the money and then come have a full purse to do ministry. Just come, follow me. Our move here in July of 2021 was out of an obedience just like that same obedience of Matt, don't worry about it. What's interesting, what kept me in Michigan for a long time, the man that gave me all the books and was leading me theologically in February 2nd of 2006, we were at a conference together. And the last speaker of the conference is a missionary. His name is David Sitton. He is a missionary to the unreached people group of the mountains of eastern Mexico. And he asked for a tithe of 10% of that room of pastors to leave your pastor's wall office and come follow me. Leave your office, men. Come follow me. There's more work to be done for the kingdom, announcing and declaring salvation out of your walls than in your walls. And I was crushed. Sitting there beside Dan in this auditorium, we're singing the closing song, and I am just like overwhelmed of spirit. Matt, follow me. Come. Leave the walls of your office. Let's go. Hindsight's pretty interesting to see what the Lord does to prepare us. Didn't get on a plane like I normally would that afternoon. It was the end of the conference. We stayed another day, had it scheduled to stay another day. My senior pastor sitting across the table from me asked me this. Man, I can preach a theologically accurate sermon that outweighs the rest of them, but I've never experienced what you're experiencing today. That is called a rhythm of grace, where the Holy Spirit lands on you in such a way that it's easy to recognize the conversations you're having with people are literally like crossing a raging river, but you're meant to get on the other side 2 miles down, so let the current take you and have the conversation. You're not trying to get across the river. You're just going to get across it at some time. Dan looks at me and says, I need you to commit to me. I need you to stay here with me. I'm like, what's that mean? He goes, our church isn't aimed missionally at all. I need your help. I'll write sermons, but I need help aiming it to be on mission. Help me do that. So I committed. I'll just stay. I'll stay with you. 7 months later, he was diagnosed with stage 4 terminal cancer. 2 years to the day after that, I walk into his hospital room completely led by the Holy Spirit. I'm in my office working in church and just thinking, I haven't heard. I wonder how Dan's doing. I'm going to go to the hospital and visit him. Little did I know that that day I'd call my wife at the end of the day as I walked out of the hospital and say, I have now been released from the duty which I agreed to stay for. And I was by his bedside as he passed that day. And I called my wife, and the only words I said to her, my job here is done. We need to ask the Lord for what's next. Spirit-filled, gospel-giving conversations are only edified or only good when the Spirit is in the middle of your sharing of the gospel, not you ramrodding it as men into other people's lives. So back to the prayer circle, the cause circle. Pray, 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 trust, pray. Ask the Lord, I need an entrance ramp to get on this conversation, and I need an exit ramp to get back out of it, and I need to be led by your Spirit through it. If you want to see life change, understand you surrender, Lord, you use me in the lives of other people. Let's go. So, church, I say to you, let's go. Be the safest place for one another to enter this room with a high five, with a hug, with a greet of some measure to understand this church is for the edification of God's name, great. At the same time, the equipping of you and I to be the best brothers and sisters possible and know each other's hurts and sorrows and preach the gospel to each other in it. God's got a plan for you. It's not cliche language. It's truth. This shall not be the place that anyone comes in that they feel like they weren't connected to or loved. There's only one of me. There's only one of Chad. There's only one Andy. That's only three of us. There's only one Zach. It takes a church to be the church. Do you understand what I'm saying? the best plan for this building that it's too small. Amen? Because you love the Lord's work in your life so significantly, you're willing to share it with someone else. Again, amen? It just means you agree. Let me pray for us. Lord, we recognize that it's your name that is glorified through our lives and our actions. And Lord, out of our lives, I pray that you would protect the living of our life to be a clear statement of who you are. Lord, as many other great theologians and pastors have said that we all know, Lord, may we, when necessary, use words that match the actions of our lives. Lord, I pray that we would be emboldened, that we would understand the statement that you said to the Pharisees when they're trying to trick you. Lord, I pray that we would love you greater than ourselves and we love our neighbor as well. Lord, I pray that you'd help us. Lord, I pray that there would be great stories where people come back in weeks to come and say, you won't believe of the conversation I have. I didn't even plan it. And with that, I would say, amen. Lord, may we see the rhythms of grace and step out in obedience and not quench the Spirit's work where I know the thing that helps and can help someone the most. Not because I know, because you've made it known to us. Lord, go before us, help us, equip us, prepare us for your name's sake, not ours. In Christ's name, we all say together, amen. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for working through this with me. There's a lot there. If you have any questions or comments, later see Chad. No, I'm kidding. You can see me. Thank you. You are dismissed.